Welcome to another episode of Citizen Pinoy, special episode, Your Tanong, My Sagot. Ordinarily, we used to have, if you remember, social distancing style, where we would have people asking questions via Zoom. Well, now we zoomed the person in really close up, and we have with us for our first question, Chris. Welcome to Citizen Pinoy.
Thank you, attorney.
And I also know Chris's wife, Pam, was a client of mine from many, many years ago. And what had happened was you were the subject of her issues.
That's correct.
In that they were trying to get a tourist visa for you. But when she consulted way back, I think in 2007, I said, bakit a tourist visa? The POGI is eligible for an immigrant visa, right? Which is better, tourist visa or immigrant visa? So we were able to help you get your immigrant visa to come to the U.S., be reunited with her. And thank you very much for having such faith and trust in our office, as well as your asawa, who's an RN in our office. But you're finished, you're a citizen, and yes. Now ano ang problema?
Yes, thank you, attorney, for having us today.
Sure.
I applied for naturalization
okay.
in 2012.
Okay.
And then 2013, I petitioned my mom.
Okay.
And she came over to the U.S. in 2013.
Okay.
And 2014, she went back to the Philippines to take care of my dad. He was sick. And then mm-hmm. until she was green card. But she stayed there until my dad passed away in 19.
And so 5 years she was in the Philippines.
And then she's still up over there. And my question is, if she decides to come back to the U.S., would there be any problem, or will they allow her to come back to the U.S. after so many years of staying there with a green card?
Okay. All right, so bottom line is an immigrant goes back to the Philippines, and how it works is if a green card holder is outside the U.S. for more than a year, it is considered that they have abandoned their green card unless they can demonstrate that the reason that they were outside the U.S. was for reasons beyond their control. I'm seeing that happening a lot, especially with people who may have gone back to the Philippines as green card holders, let's say in 2019, and then they got stuck because of COVID.
Right.
Of course, your mom does not have that reasoning because
right.
she went back in 2014.
Yes.
So there are a couple of options. One is she can apply for what is called a returning resident visa, or SB1, Samboy 1, at the U.S. Embassy, where she would have to demonstrate that for all of those years, it was for reasons beyond her control. Almost as though your father was in ICU, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. The hospital records and showing it truly was for reasons beyond her control. Other choices are, is her green card still valid, or has it expired?
I think so. I think it's still valid.
Yeah, I mean, the other one is if she flew into the U.S., then she would make her presentation to Customs and Border Protection at the airport, whether they will accept it or not. Another one is, in this case, because you are a U.S. citizen child, you can file a new petition for her. It's not like you're a brother or sister where it's going to take another 20 years.
Right.
That may be another option if she
okay.
cannot document or support the 5 years of beyond her control that he was constantly in need of care. But those would be the options
okay.
for her.
Okay.
And I wish the best for your family as well. I mean, because we've been around with each
yeah.
other since at least 2007.
Yes.
So I wish the best for your mom.
Yes,
so,
thank you.
Claro?
Yes. Clear.
Okay.
Salamat po.
Welcome back to Citizen Pinoy, Your Tanong, My Sagot, in-person style versus social distancing. Joining me now for his question is Ruther. Welcome to Citizen Pinoy.
Thank you for having me here, attorney.
Okay, thank you too. So, what's your question? Ano ang problema?
This is my question, attorney. My mother is a U.S. citizen. She petitioned my brother last 2014, and my brother received a notice of immigrant visa creation last year, May 2021. Unfortunately, my mother passed away last May 2019.
Mm-hmm. My condolences to you and your family.
Thank you, Attorney. We heard that when the petitioner passes away, the petition dies also.
Mm-hmm.
So because of this, I want to know if there are any other options to consider my brother coming here in the U.S.
Okay. How old's your brother?
He's 32 years old.
Okay. And what does he do for work? What does he know how to do?
He has a business in the Philippines right now.
All right, so the question is common to many people. They are petitioned, and of course it takes many, many years, and then while waiting, the petitioner dies. So you're now receiving, or the family is now receiving paperwork from the National Visa Center, basically saying, it's getting close, already start submitting the fees, filling out the forms, logging in to the website so we can get ready. So when the priority date becomes current, we're ready to queue you up for interview. The reason you're receiving that paperwork is the National Visa Center does not yet know the petitioner's dead. They still think that they are alive. Because a lot of people think getting the notices from NVC is a sign from heaven that it's okay. You realize that is not the case. And you are correct that when the petitioner dies, the petition dies with them unless you apply for and are granted humanitarian revalidation. Humanitarian revalidation is one of those issues that has bothered me a lot. And I'll be honest with you and you, and I've spoken about it many times on Citizen Pinoy, in that you have to file the humanitarian revalidation request at the service center where the petition was originally filed or approved. So for those of you where the case was filed and approved at the California Service Center in Laguna Niguel, they have a horrible record of approving humanitarian revalidation requests. Their approval rate is roughly 5%. They pretty much look for ways to deny cases. I have brought this to the attention of the USCIS Ombudsman in Washington, D.C., that this is like a systemic problem. It's not that where they are adjudicating cases, they're just simply how many they can deny each day. That's the California Service Center. So if the case, and we don't have the receipt here with us to find out where it was filed, but we are here in New York, and the petitioner lived in New York at the time. So I'm going to assume perhaps the petition was filed at the Vermont Service Center and approved there. If that's the case, while no guarantee, there is PAGASA. The other service centers at least exercise some discretion and they will approve some cases. Among the requirements is certain close relatives, such as a brother, would submit an affidavit of support as a substitute sponsor and make the presentation demonstrating why the family is deserving of the service center exercising humanitarian compassion and reinstating. If they do, then the case continues and, God willing, the visa is issued to them. If humanitarian revalidation is not available, or it's a California service center, you could find an employer. A person can immigrate either through family petition or through an employer's petition. I've done that many times where even family can petition family members for a green card through employment, housekeepers, caregivers, other things like that. So that could be another option. Any other questions, though?
No more. Sorry.
Okay. And I hope that if this situation applies to you, that you have also found this information informative, and thank you for your question.
Thank you, Attorney.
And our next question comes from Ben. Welcome to Citizen Pinoy.
Thank you.
So what is your question?
First of all, I want to thank you for having me. My question is about my Down syndrome daughter.
Okay.
Who is living with us here in New Jersey.
How old is she?
She is 36 now, I think.
Okay.
I have a letter from immigration.
Okay.
So I pick it up and we saw the letter. There was an address there for Manila, Philippines. I think that will be the interview. So we were thinking, me and my wife and my sons, we were thinking about why still they want to interview Abigail in Manila while she is here already.
And she's on DACA now as well,
yes,
correct?
Yes, okay. Abigail was on DACA.
And she just keeps renewing
keeps
it for
renewing
now.
It.
Okay, so the situation is they have an adult single daughter, tago ng tago, right? She was TNT, mm-hmm. right? And on DACA, they petitioned her. The priority date is getting close, and so the National Visa Center is sending notices. And the question is, she's here in the U.S., and they're wondering, can she be interviewed in the U.S.,
yes.
or does she have to go home, correct?
Yes.
All right, some of the issues, let me just identify some of the issues. Ordinarily, if a person is tago ng tago, they are not eligible to be interviewed for a green card in the U.S., unless, for example, they're being petitioned by a U.S. citizen as a parent, a minor child, not an adult child, a minor child,
yes.
or a spouse. That's
yes.
called immediate relative. I don't have that. She was petitioned as an adult. So there was also other laws that if they were petitioned, let's say, before April 2001, which she was not, also possibly be able to be interviewed for a green card in America. Does not look like she has that available. So what they're saying is because she's tago ng tago, she has to go back. If she leaves the U.S., she'll be subject to a 10-year bar.
Mm-hmm.
But as I featured on my show, she could apply for what is called a provisional waiver. A provisional waiver is where before you leave, you ask for forgiveness or a waiver of the 10-year bar based on extreme hardship to parents. If it's approved, then you're able to go back to the Philippines, apply for the visa without worrying about the 10-year bar. But I'm also a little bit nervous about that as well, mm-hmm. having her go back. Because once they leave, the consul may find something else.
Mm-hmm.
The provisional waiver waives only the 10-year bar. I know, especially during Trump, they may have said, oh, she's going to be a public charge.
Yes.
That's an issue there as well. In addition, the embassy is still digging themselves out from under the tremendous amount of backlog they have in scheduling interviews because of the, you know, the immigration ban, the shutdown, the slowdown, the embassy was closed. On the other hand, when you are notified that a visa is available, you have 1 year to contact the National Visa Center.
Yes.
If you do not, then they begin steps to terminate the case. So, you know, certainly one option is the provisional waiver, go home and hope that they issue the visa, she comes back. Another one is contact the National Visa Center. You know, please be advised, we are still interested. You know, every 11 months or every year, make sure there is a written contact. Don't call up because there's no evidence of that. Call up every year to keep the case active, and it resets that 1 year clock. And then let's just monitor the situation in terms of the embassy opening up again, seeing how they're entertaining and processing the provisional waiver cases. Because there was another issue where people on provisional waiver would get it approved, go back, and then they were being charged with fraud for having come to the U.S. and, I don't know, working within 90 days or things like that. So we want to see how they are reacting. In addition, another thing to pray for is there has been long discussions about giving the DACA kids a pathway to legalization on DACA alone. There's been a lot of discussion in Congress about granting them an amnesty or pathway to legalization and citizenship. Maybe that'll happen in the next couple of years, we hope, as long as the Democrats and the Republicans can compromise on some things. So, which do you send her back on the provisional waiver and hope the visa's issued, or see what happens in terms of the embassies opening up, their approach to provisional waivers, and or developments in DACA and the DREAM Act? Mm-hmm. Welcome back to Citizen Pinoy, and joining me now is Nikki. Nikki used to work for Star Cinema and ABS-CBN, but also has an immigration problem. Welcome to Citizen Pinoy.
Hi, thank you for having me.
So ano ang problema?
I have been a green card holder since 2016, and I fly in and out of the country. When I petitioned my husband 2019, then pandemic hit, the process of the papers was put on hold, or put on hold.
Slowed down, shut down, and reduced staffing.
Now he is here with us, with our family, on a tourist visa, and we applied for an extension of his stay.
Okay.
My question is he allowed to take the interview here?
So he arrived in the U.S. as a tourist more than 6 months ago.
Yes.
And you've already filed an extension.
That's right.
What was the reason you were giving for the extension?
Well, my son is already studying in school. He's in grade 2. And I'm working here. Mm-hmm. And we don't have anyone to take my son to school and pick him up and to take care of him. Mm-hmm. That's why we decided to have to get his extension, to apply for his extension, and hope he gets extended so that while I go to work, he's tending to our son.
Okay. All right. It can be very, very tricky and confusing to both be in the U.S. or enter the U.S. as a visitor and at the same time want to get an immigrant visa or a green card. And the problem with that is that you have issues of potential fraud. And I'll explain what the fraud is, because I saw your eyebrows go up. So here's how it works. When a person enters the U.S. as a tourist, or when they apply for a tourist visa, realistically, they cannot have a brain cell in their head thinking that they want to immigrate. They're basically, when they come to the U.S. and they're at the airport and the officer says, "What's the purpose?" "I'm just going to visit and I have every intention of returning." Mm-hmm. That's what a tourist visa has. On the other hand, you're saying, can he stay and apply for the immigrant visa? So it's like giving a contradictory intent. You know, I do not plan to stay, but I want to stay. So that's the issue there. There are a couple of rules. The USCIS has what's called the 30-60-day rule. The embassy has the 90-day rule, which is that if a person comes into the U.S. as a tourist, and then 30 or 60 days later, they change their mind, then they could, you know, pursue either change of status or file adjustment of status, as long as they did not violate their existing status or work without authorization. So technically, like 60 days after he arrived, he possibly could have applied for adjustment of status, but we're beyond that now. Mm-hmm. Now he's in an extension, and he would need to have that extension. It would seem he would need to get that extension approved to keep the bridge going, but what's the reasoning? I need him to stay and watch my kid. That doesn't sound like a, quote, temporary type of arrangement. Mm-hmm. And also, if the USCIS, you know, finds out he's under petition, they're going to say, "We don't think that it is your plan just to visit and then depart," and which kind of like contradicts the basis for getting the extension as well. Then if it gets denied and he's out of status for more than 6 months and then he leaves, he can be subject to the 3 and the 10-year bar. So right now, if he were, let's say hypothetically today, he files for adjustment of status, he would need to get the extension approved to bridge him, you know, from when his I-94 expired till now. Mm. But to get that approved, you have to show I have no intent to immigrate. Mm. In the meantime, he's intending to immigrate, so it creates an issue there. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, actually, he doesn't have plans of staying, of overstaying.
Right.
He is totally fine to, he has actually a ticket going back home.
Yeah, yeah.
But then we decided for our son to go to school, and summer would be till July, till June. So we were just planning for him to stay until June, then go back to the Philippines, the reason why we applied for his extension, so that while our son is in school, I'm at work, he can tend to him. But then we don't have any intention of him staying here, like, until we wait for the interview. He's really okay. We are really okay to follow and abide by the law and by the letter of the USCIS that you have to go home and take your interview there for the petition. Yeah. But my question is the reason, well, my question is he allowed to take the interview here when we get the letter?
Well, the problem is he would need to get that extension approved so he maintains status. But to get the extension approved, he has to show he has no intention to be interviewed in the U.S. You follow me? He's contradicting himself. I need my extension, which requires me to prove I'm going to go home so that I don't have to go home. And that creates the issue. It would have been far more simple, you know, 60 days after he arrived. Because, in fact, I had a show, an episode where somebody was under petition. They had come in as tourists, again, no intention
of staying,
and then like 4 months later, they were consulting because they were getting the NVC paperwork. They were not yet on an extension, and he had not violated status. So in that case, they were able to. But now you're already needing that, like I said, the extension approved of the tourist visa, which requires I do not intend to remain, so that he can remain, so it creates the issue there. So he may be required under the technicalities to have to go home, okay? To be safe, all right?
Okay.
All right, very, very good question. I wish I could give the black and white answer or the answer they want, but when people come to me for consultations, I want to just advise them according to the law versus what they want to hear, because sometimes what they want to hear, what they want to do is different from what the law allows. Okay, but thank you very, very much for your question. I enjoyed myself with Yorthanong Mai Sagot. And I also provide information, news and developments on my YouTube channel, U.S. Immigration TV. Make sure after this show and all the credits and all that stuff, go to your computer, have your child or your grandchild show you how to log on to YouTube. Isn't it true now how things are? Before we'd say to the kids, get away from that. Now it's, please show me how to log in. And make sure to like, share, and subscribe to U.S. Immigration TV. Again, because I'm posting what I consider to be information that you or somebody you know may find useful. Immigration news, immigration developments, and hopefully it can be helpful to you. And also, while we're here, Citizen Pinoy. Again, public service providing you with information, success stories that may be informative and inspirational to you. Until next time, ako po si Michael Gerfinkel. I will see you on Citizen Pinoy.
Kapamilya in the Chicagoland area. Citizen Pinoy is coming back.
We're going to have Yorthanong Mai Sagot live on May 22nd, 2022. So go to my Facebook page for details and reservations. Perhaps you can be on Citizen Pinoy for your Tanong, My Sagot, and have your question answered.
Choose from two schedules, 10 a.m. or 3 p.m.
I look forward to seeing you.
Kapag na-miss mo, pwedeng balikan. Pwedeng panoorin ang videos at playlists na gusto mo. Like, comment, at ishare ang videos kasama ng lumalaki nating pamilya sa online world. Kahit kailan, kahit saan pa, forever tayong kapamilya. Kapamilya Online Live!